Great, great. Before we come to you, Annette, Diana, we kind of started talking about it, but then we were distracted a little. The unsolved murders in Rhode Island, can you give us some statistics on that?
Sure. As of now, we're up to 104 unsolved murders. Unfortunately, Essence is number 91. This year, we are up to 12 homicide, 10 being African American and 2 Hispanic.
That's good.
No, I think she means like her giving the information.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, one is too many, like I said earlier.
Okay.
So, just awful. So, you've been involved with talking to, I guess, the police. I don't really want to talk about them, but I want to talk more about you and what you're doing. And then we're going to go right to Annette. And if you hear me call her Pooh, that's the name I've called her since high school. And she will be Pooh on this sofa. And she's okay with that. So what type of efforts are you leading to see that these unsolved murders become solved?
So,
or what can we do as well?
Right. The reason why, as Helen has said, is I just feel like 104 is a large number for our city. Way too many. I did speak with a couple of people, and so far they're leaving it as once a case is considered a cold case, they usually have to have one of the acting detectives to step up and want to decide to reopen that case. But I feel like those efforts are not good enough. We need someone who is positioned to be on those cases and looking at them at least yearly. Like, we shouldn't have to wait until someone decides that they want to just, you know, look back into that case. So beginning next year, I will be reaching out and try to start some sort of committee so that we can step up these efforts to have someone assigned to these cold cases.
We need to. So as long as you get, as soon as you get information, you can give it to me.
Correct.
And then I can, you know, publish it on my Facebook or whatever, because we need to come together in order to push people that are in those positions to begin to get these cases solved. And it's not just that we're not snitching. It's not that.
Right.
Because some of these officers, they do know who is doing what.
Correct.
You know? And we need to, it just got to work a little harder.
Correct.
You know, so that at least that can be solved and we can move forward.
Yes.
Because let alone having all those murders, then all those being unsolved,
correct,
it doesn't make any sense, because most of these guys who are killing each other, they're in the same groups.
Correct.
So
yes,
it's not even like it's someone foreign, you know, from another state just coming in here and all the time. So, yeah, but thank you. Thank you for all the advocacy and what you're doing to, you know, find some remedy for this situation that we're in, especially when it deals with gun violence. Just awful, just awful. So now to you, Pooh. So a lot of people, some people here might not know who you are. Tell us some things about, tell us about you.
My name is Annette Perry. I'm 47 years old. I've been living in the Washington Park area since I was 14. I'm married, have 2 kids. Well, one of my sons passed, as you know. I work with children. I'm a program director working with children, teenage adolescents. And I'm just trying to get through this. It's hard, really hard.
Yeah. Well, I do know your husband.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you, I don't know if you'd like to share this. How did you meet Ron beside, well, how did you connect? Because he was in, was he in school with us or was he?
No, he went to Central.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like in the same, click.
I met Ronnie by hanging at my sister's house.
Okay.
Yeah, she lived in Wiggins Village.
Mm-hmm.
And he hung with family members, so.
Yeah, nice. All right, and you have 2 kids, so tell us something about Dimitri, because your son does have a name.
Yes, he does.
tell us something wonderful about him that we will remember. So when we see you, Boo, Annette Perry, we'll remember your son.
He was a big teddy bear. He would give you the shirt up his back. He was always there to help anybody. He was just a loving kid.
Yeah, and we kind of hear that story often about how great our kids were. And before you go into that, you know, as a people, period, we've all done things, done something wrong. No one is spotless,
right.
You know. But a lot of our kids, they're not really bad kids. They're just kind of in a situation that, or they're around people that these bad things begin to happen. And you know your child because you raised them. I know you, you're a good person, you know. And we can raise our children to be good people, but sometimes these things happen. It's the people they're around. And, you know, yeah, it does, it does. So tell us what happened. How did you find out?
I was on the phone with him when he got shot.
Oh, God.
I was just getting out of work. My phone rang. It was him. He was talking to me. I'm telling him to come to the house. He made a stop along the way, and end up shooting him.
Okay, so you went to the hospital?
No, I called 911 from the house phone. And I'm calling my sister from my cell phone, telling everybody where he was, because I knew where he had stopped at.
Right.
And the rescue took forever to get there. So my two sons, because Ronnie has other kids outside of the ones we have together, I told both of them where their brother was at, and the other ones who went there, they actually got to him before the ambulance did.
Oh,
God.
When I hear these stories, I can just feel it, you know, as if it was my child. And like I said in the very beginning, I don't understand, but I can understand. I can feel the pain, even though my child is still here, as to if something like this had happened to her. And just as I told Diana, you're very strong, because you have to live through this every single day, the memories. The emotional roller coaster. I'm just thinking as I'm talking, and I thank you because you're sharing. And I'm here for you. I don't quite know what to do, but pray for you. If you need an ear, if you just want to cry, or if you just want to just sit and just whatever, nothing. I'm here. And this is our community. This is what we see all too often, you know. But we need to build. We need to build from this, because it shouldn't be more mothers on this sofa telling their stories. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't. It just needs to stop. These are our babies. Our children are supposed to bury us, not us burying our kids.
Nah.
And our kids need us. And, you know, a lot of this stuff honestly came from the crack era, because we didn't have guns and things of that nature. They might have been doing this in Oakland, California, but we weren't doing that here. We would fist fight, you know, we would argue and those things, and go on about our business, and then hopefully, you know, mend those relationships. Well, the parents would step in and mend those relationships, because that's what we're supposed to do. But those things are not, didn't happen after the crack era. We had money, we had hip hop, which really makes our kids think that it's okay to go to jail. It's okay to shoot someone. It's okay to degrade your girlfriend or women and things of that nature. It's okay, but it's not okay because we get to this.
Right.
You know, and there's other efforts that we have to do. Like we, you know, I know our kids love rap music, but we have to say no to some of the seriously negative stuff that our babies are listening to day in and day out. And then it becomes a part of them, even though we've raised good children,
right?
You know? So what have you done to keep his legacy alive?
Well, I do a memorial every year for him. I have a great support system, my family. my best friends, because I can just go over the fence and give Diana something else I will.
Nice.
My niece Trina, she's in the audience. She, big support system. Like I said, I have a big family. And I just thank God for them, because I don't know what I would do.
And the thing is, a lot of people don't have access to that support system that you have. And again, I'm hoping some other, because I know there are other mothers in this city. Like he said, there's 104 that are unsolved, mm-hmm. and then we have some that are solved. However, that's when that group needs to form,
right.
So that you guys can talk and grow and begin to do some real community advocacy at that point, because you can do it through experience, you know.
Yeah.
And we need that support. Our sons need good role models. They need to know that they're loved, that they're important, that they have a future. But we don't see a lot of that on TV. We don't hear a lot of that in the music. So what else are our babies to do? But because you guys are doing a lot of community involvement, while you're involved in the community and doing a lot of things to help bridge the gap between the broken and the unbroken, a difference is being made. It's just so small right now.
True.
And it takes all of us to begin to make the necessary changes, you know. So I thank you. I really do thank you. You also, what else do you do in your bio? It said that you do some of the transients and things of that nature.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
I, like I said, I'm a program director, and I have youth, a lot of youth, transgender, where it's hard for them. So they help me as far as taking them to different groups and that they have in the community, and just working with the kids, just keep them busy, keep my mind off things. So I try to keep going and stay busy all the time.
Right, right. But I'm sure at this point now you can instill some good values into them. Probably a lot of them don't have that or had that,
right.
Or they wouldn't be in these programs,
true.
Unfortunately. So I have another question for you. Let's see. So you and Diana, you guys have a group. Do you guys have a group of mothers already established that have lost children?
Well, I don't. I mean, I talk to Diana a lot.
Mm-hmm.
My nephew was killed a couple of years ago. Myra Latimer, that's my niece.
Mm-hmm.
I stay in contact with them a lot.
Okay. And I was only asking, just in case there's someone who is watching and they want to know, is there this support group there that they can actually be a part of? So if someone had asked me for your information, would it be okay that I give it to them?
Yes, sure.
So that they can talk to you?
Okay.
Because sometimes that does happen, you know.
Sure.
Just thank you, ladies, so much for all that you're doing in the community. Thank you for being strong. We love you, your community. Loves you, and we're going to be better because you guys are reaching out and trying to make a difference through the means and methods that you have.
Can I add one more thing?
Thank you, so Helen, as far as the unsolved murders. Also, I just wanted everyone to know that with the unsolved murders, we need also for the authorities to know that all of these murders should be looked at in the same manner. Mm-hmm. I feel like a lot of the reasons why they're not solved is because it may have been that they felt that one murder was more important than the other, and we can't have that. We need everyone's murder to
That's
be
true.
Exactly the same, no matter what the circumstance was, no matter how that person, you know, was prior to them being murdered. They're still human. They're still people, and they still need the same respect that everyone else's murder gets. So,
I think for a long time our community has been bogged down with so many issues. And I want to use this word, but we've also become, we have become desensitized to all these things, to the point where we don't even advocate for ourselves anymore. And sometimes it's because we know we're not going to get the justice we deserve like others get.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we're tired.
Right.
We're hopeless and things of that nature. But we need to understand that it's not just about us. It's about our babies that are coming up after us. We don't want to continue to repeat this cycle, take pride in ourselves and who we are. We are somebody. Our kids matter. We matter. But if we're not fighting for our kids and we're not standing up here advocating for them, then our kids won't advocate for theirs.
Right.
And then this continued cycle. So it's that, it's where at this point we have to continue to let us know how important we are. And not be afraid, because sometimes we're afraid if we go to the police, they're going to harass us and those things. But, you know, that's when you start getting police badges, you start making notes and letting people know what's going on, who did you contact and all that. And we need to do it as a community because we're stronger together.
Yes.
So that we can, our babies can know that we are there for them. You know, just talking to some of the guys in the community, they actually feel as though they're not going to live. So why go do anything? Why go be anybody if I might not live to see tomorrow? And I'm only just saying because all these things are coupled together. You know. So if we're out here and we're showing our kids that we care for them and we're advocating for them and we're going to be there until the last day, then that gives them hope. And then they'll begin to fight for and advocate for themselves as well as their kids. So I thank you again. I thank you, ladies. It's sad that you guys had to go through this to do certain things, but sometimes bad things happen,
right.
But good things come out of them, you know? And again, as I told Diana, I'm here. I'm here for you. I don't know what I can do. I really don't, but I can do something. And I will give you what I have, rather it's time, rather it's an ear, rather it's a resource, whatever it might be. If I have it, you got it.
Thank you.
And I mean that. Again, let's, you know, continue to build in our community, continue to talk in our community so that we can move forward. Because we're great. We are great people. No, for real, you guys hear me on my live and stuff. We are a phenomenal people.
Did I say that?
We are. We're awesome, and we have to internalize that and believe it for ourselves, in order for us to begin to sprout and be great again, because we are. We have a lot of resources in our community. We have a lot of talents. We have a lot of gifts. And I think our babies don't feel as if they're worth anything. And that's because society doesn't make them feel like they're worth anything. TV doesn't make them feel like they're worth anything. And now our babies feel like they need something else to make them feel worthy. When their worthiness is right here in this community. You can do anything. You can be anything. So, again, thank you so much. We're going to turn off our live. Thank you, guys. Wait. No, I was going to ask anybody live if they had a couple of questions. But anyway, thank you for tuning in live. Probably didn't see my face through this whole live video, but thank you again. And I hope to see you in February at our show for Black History First here in Rhode Island. Our January show is sold out. This one is sold out. Thank you. You guys did it. I didn't do anything. How's this? God did it. But thank you for being obedient. And we'll see you guys around. God bless you.